the different parents to come up and like, give us a few minutes on what they're hearing from So, to start, I'd like to welcome Vanessa Gutierrez, who's a member of the Kawasaki Disease Foundation, to report on the U.S. and introduce what's going on with the registry.
Hi, my name is Vanessa Gutierrez, and I was invited to serve on the board for the foundation about 3 years ago. And ever since then, it's been an honor to work with the parents nationwide. So I'm going to speak a little bit about what the foundation has been doing to support different parents' efforts to raise awareness. So basically, the foundation has been supporting awareness initiatives since 2000. And over the past few years, they have been distributing symptoms posters to parents who request them nationwide at no cost. Parents then distribute them at their communities, either at hospitals, daycares, different locations to raise awareness of Kawasaki disease. We also have our social media pages where several parents come for support in promoting events that they're hosting to raise awareness of Kawasaki disease. A lot of them are blood drives, bracelets in their schools. They had a couple months ago, there was a haunted house in Texas to raise awareness and funds for Kawasaki disease. So there's been different initiatives to raise awareness, and the foundation has been supporting them throughout the way. Recently, the foundation has partnered with Stanford Courts to help raise awareness of the actual numbers of Kawasaki disease cases nationwide. So I'm going to introduce Katie Olson, who's here from Courts Registry, so she can speak about what the process is in registering your child.
Of Rare Diseases at Stanford, better known as the CORDS Registry. The CORDS Registry is a database of clinical information and contact information for individuals with rare diseases. It's an international registry. Last November, we launched a KD-specific registry with a KD-specific survey for participants to fill out. Researchers have access to de-identified information in the registry, and they can identify people who might be eligible for research studies. There's no cost for anyone involved, not for researchers, not for PDF, and not for participants. Participants and families that choose to get involved contribute information to the registry by filling out a short survey. They may learn about research opportunities for which they're eligible. And if we notify you about opportunities, you do have the opportunity to decline those if that's what your comfort level is. We have three different enrollment options. You can enroll online at the link listed on our slide. You can also enroll by mail or in person with me today. I have surveys laying on the KDF table just out in the hallway. If you choose to enroll online, as many people do, you'll want to visit our screening form, which is available on our website. It's a very short screen, about 10 questions. Once we have your completed screening form, we will send you a secure username, password, and a link to our online portal. Once you're on the portal, you'll actually fill out the survey itself. Following enrollment, so after you've filled out the survey, we will remind you on an annual basis to go in and update your information. If a researcher identifies you as a person who might be eligible for research, we will contact you. And there's no obligation to participate in that research, as I said. You can change your preferences at any time or withdraw. Currently, we have 36 fully enrolled participants. We also have an additional 57 who are in the screening status. We have people enrolled from 17 different states and 4 different countries, and that's just since November. If anyone has questions, I'm more than happy to answer them. And as I said, we do have material out at the KDF booth.
Do we have any questions for Katie? I do want to emphasize that this is an internationally available registry. It's not unique to the US or Canada. Anyone from around the world can register. Mr. Asai from the Japanese Parent Association now.
Good evening. In Japanese, please head on. Nihonno Kawasaki Byou no Kodomo Motsu Oya no Kai no Asai Mitsuru to moujimasu. 第11回国際川崎病シンポジウムでペアレンツアソシエーションシンポジウムを設定していただいてありがとうございます。アメリカの KDF のグレゴリー・キンさんをはじめ関係者の皆様に御礼申し上げます。私たちは本日私たち川崎子どもの持つ親の会の日本における32年の歴史歩みを紹介させていただきます。このマークは私たちのシンボルマークで、テーマは支え合うです。川崎病の子供を持つ親の会は1982年9月に発足しました。写真はその発会式の様子です。会員数約1200家族、都道府県単位の連絡会支部が32できております。活動資金は会員の方の会費の年間4500円と個人から寄せられる寄付です。活動内容を紹介します。2ヶ月に1回会報山べこ通信を発行し、全国の会員の方に送るとともに、川崎富作先生をはじめご協力いただいている医師研究者に送っています。現在 A4 サイズ16ページに毎回2300部印刷しており、194号まで完成しております。アメリカの KDF のグレゴリー・キンさんをはじめ海外の先生方にも送っています。本日参加されているカナダ、オーストラリア、ハワイの親の会のメンバーの方がご希望であれば毎回送らせてもらいます。声をかけてください。そして川崎病関連図書もこれまで6冊発行しております。写真は親の会のリーフレット川崎病展です。日本では川崎病は原因不明のまま増え続けていますが、まだまだ正確な情報は届いていないのが現状です。この度このリーフレットの改訂版を作成し、日本全国に普及させようという活動に力を入れております。 A6 版14ページで今お手元に配らせていただきました。山部通信の発行とは別に、活動の大きな柱は川崎病講演会と相談会の開催です。この32年間で優に400回を超えており、500回に迫ろうとしています。その講演会と相談会の象徴的開催は、写真の第20回総会の記念事業として実施した21世紀川崎病全国キャラバンで、2001年の9月から2002年の9月までの1年間に日本全国30カ所で川崎病講演会と相談会を実施しました。写真は宮城県の様子です。参加延べ数は4003人にもなりました。また第25回総会では、今回も話題になっておりますが、川崎病にかかった本人による公開シンポジウム「川崎病私」を実施し、起用川崎病者が病者としてこの間何を感じ、どう生きてきたのか、学校生活で嫌なことを思いしたことなかったのか、自由に話してもらいました。 また25年の事業として16歳以上の罹患した本人対象のアンケート調査を実施しました。回答を寄せてくれた314人の内容を分析し、川崎病後の精神領域の問題として日本川崎病学会の一般演題で発表させていただきました。発表した内容の大きな軸は、川崎病後後遺症も抱えながらも薬を飲まなくなったり検診に行かなくなるでドロップアウトがあるということです。この現実を川崎病の全国調査対象施設約2300病院の小児科部長宛てに、上野会発行の総書4、川崎病と向き合うためにまとめて送りました。そして第30回総会はまさにそのドロップアウト防止のための事業を全国主要都市9カ所で実施しました。写真は東京での様子ですが、医師の講演だけではなく、罹患した本人の立場として、そして親の立場としてドロップアウト防止のためのシンポジウムを実施しました。写真は自治医科大学中村義和先生からお借りしたスライドです。川崎病はすでに60の国地方から報告されているとのことです。前回の京都での国際シンポジウムで声をかけさせていただきましたが、国際川崎病デーを設定し、その日の前後に世界の各地で川崎病に関するイベントを実施するというのを提案させていただきます。じゃあそのインターナショナル川崎ディジーズデーを1にするかが問題ですが、実は川崎先生の最初のペーパーは1月19日に受理されているんです。ただし1月の場合、日本ではなかなか難しいので、川崎先生の誕生日である実は2月7日なんですが、7日を国際川崎病デーにしたらどうかと思いますが、いかがでしょうか。ご検討ください。最後の写真です。20世紀の大人たちがやり残した仕事の一つに、川崎病の原因究明があります。結果、21世紀の子どもたちが川崎病で苦しんでおります。私たち21世紀の子どもたちのためにも、川崎病の子どもを持つ親の会の活動を続けていくことを最後にお伝えし、私の話を終えます。ご清聴ありがとうございました。
Thank you, Mr. Stein. Much to learn from you. Next up is a report from Hawaii from Sandra Sato. Please come up.
Aloha. Thank you, Kawasaki Disease Foundation, for this opportunity to speak to you about our awareness efforts. It is truly an honor to be here. My name is Sandra Sato, and I'm from Hilo, Hawaii. I'm here with my family, my husband, Troy, our children, Evelyn. Will and Maya. Maya was diagnosed in 2012 at the age of 3 months. At the time of her diagnosis, I had heard of KD but had no idea of the devastating effects it would have on a child's heart. Luckily, Maya did not develop aneurysms, but she does have some dilation and takes an aspirin daily. My family decided to bring awareness to KD. with Evan being a huge driving force behind this. As you all understand the trauma that this illness can put on a family, Evan felt strongly that every person should be aware of KD. He started by writing to our mayor, Billy Kinoy, asking to have January 26th recognized as Kawasaki Disease Awareness Day for the County of Hawaii. He received a proclamation by the mayor in 2014 and 2015. Evan also handed out flyers and 1-inch button magnets to his schoolmates since last year. This year, he did a brief KD presentation to students in the library. He also made use of the media. We went on the radio to promote KD Awareness Day. This station, B93B97, broadcast live island-wide, as well as did live online streaming. The disc jockey mentioned that he has friends who listen from places as far away as Norway, Canada, and Australia. He also recorded the interview so we could share it with our friends later. This year, Evan had a segment on a TV program called Living in Paradise, which is a cable public access program put on by a local grocery store, KTA Superstores. They highlight community events and activities and broadcast the show twice daily for a month. The segments are also uploaded onto YouTube. This year, we had our inaugural Stepping Up for KD. We wanted to plan an annual event that is fun, family-friendly, and heart-healthy, and came up with a 10-day pedometer walkathon. We chose it to last for 10 days to mimic the 10-day window that KD patients have to start IVIG treatment. Participants were asked to set a daily goal of how many steps they were planning to take, as well as how many people they would inform about KD. The collection of donations was optional. Their registration kit included a heart-shaped pedometer, an informational booklet, and a 1-inch button to advertise the event, and a worksheet to log their steps and turn in at the end of the walkathon. It kicked off on January 17th and ended on Kawasaki Disease Awareness Day on January 26th. On our kickoff day, we registered participants, answered questions about KD, passed out posters to those who were able to display them, and walk around the field to log our first 500 steps together. On the last day, we gathered to collect the worksheets and meet up with other KD families and supporters. A friend set up our database so we could set up teams, tally the steps taken, and tally the amount of people informed of KD. We also had a few donated prizes to award the participants with the best numbers. We were happy with the results at the end. We sold 83 kits and received 36 worksheets back. Collectively, we walked 2,021,032 steps, which is approximately 1,000 miles. We informed 434 people of KD and collected $1,497.21 for the Kawasaki Disease Foundation. Part of our strategy was to aim for a small success rather than a huge fail. I think we accomplished that and look forward to expanding this event next year. Whether it was passing out flyers or putting on the 10-day event, I received great feedback by those hearing of KD, whether it was for their first time or getting more information of the illness. A couple of participants of Stepping Up for KD told me that they were surprised at how many people never heard of Kawasaki disease. Then they would find out that a good friend's child had it years ago. I think if we keep talking about KD, we may get close to Evan's goal of everyone hearing about it. I wish you much success in raising awareness for KD. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandra. And Evan, great job, you're a great big brother. Reporting from Canada, we have Elizabeth Yield. Please come up, Elizabeth.
Good afternoon, aloha, and konnichiwa. My name is Elizabeth Yield, and I'm honored to take a few minutes to share a little about our new Kawasaki Disease Canada organization. There is a great contingent of Canadians here at the symposium who are involved in numerous initiatives to raise awareness of Kawasaki disease in Canada and have been doing so for many years. For us, our journey started almost 1 year ago on February 14, 2014, when a small group of founding members held our first unofficial board meeting. 3 months later, after a lot of work by some passionate volunteers, Kawasaki Disease Canada became incorporated as a Canadian not-for-profit. For many months, we worked at developing bylaws, board policies and procedures, all that fun stuff, and building all the necessary structure to sustain a national organization. On January 26th, we officially launched our corporation. Our mission and vision, like many of the organizations that you've heard from today, is to support affected individuals and families, educate the healthcare community and the public, and support Kawasaki disease research, with the ultimate goal to support the eradication of Kawasaki disease, something I'm sure we would all like to see. Now that a lot of the grunt work is done, I'm not really sure how to translate that, sorry, but now that most of the organizational work has been completed, we can start to move into areas where we will really start to feel like we're making a difference. We are actively recruiting volunteers for a number of key committees. We're also looking to expand board members and our advisory council in both the West Coast and the East Coast of Canada. We're also now in a position to apply for charitable status, something that is critically important to Canadians. Getting that income tax receipt for a donation is very important to many Canadians. Even my dad, who said, "Let me know when you're a registered charity and then I'll give you some money." So it's very important to Canadians. We have a number of educational sessions planned for both parents and healthcare professionals, as well as starting to do fund development for research. These next couple of slides are a snapshot of our reach after just a couple of days. We launched our organization via web, traditional, and social media on January 26th, as I mentioned, to coincide with Kawasaki Disease Awareness Day. We've been connecting with Canadians and others around the world on a daily and often hourly basis since then. The next few slides are images of our website, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank Greg Chin, Catherine Frank, and the rest of the Kawasaki Disease Foundation in the U.S. for their support and generosity over the last year. Greg has been a great sounding board for me personally. We made a conscious decision early on to utilize the U.S. group's images and marketing pieces, which have allowed us to allocate more resources to other things. So once again, thank you. Lastly, I'd like to read to you a message we received via our Facebook page 2 days after we launched. I am certain that each of you in this room has somehow contributed.
You're going to have to read this one.
As I practice this a few times, I can't get through without crying, but I'm certain that each of you in this room has somehow contributed to the same outcome that you will hear in this story. For us at Kawasaki Disease Canada, we could not have received a more positive reinforcement for our efforts. So here's the message. I wanted to thank you and let you know that your goal to save lives by bringing awareness to Kawasaki disease is already becoming a reality. I work in a doctor's office as a medical office assistant. On January 26th, we had a very sick little girl come to see the doctor. She had been ill with fever for days, red to sit both eyes, swollen lymph nodes, had sores on her tongues and lips, and now had developed a rash over various parts of her body. She had been seen at Lucky Clinics twice and even the hospital, each time being diagnosed with viral or bacterial illnesses. The doctor examined her and also came to the conclusion that her symptoms presented were due to a secondary strep infection and gave her a prescription with instructions to come back in a few days to be reassessed. That evening while at home, I was browsing the Kitchener Record in Canada website and came across the touching article about your son Dylan and your organization. I had heard the name Kawasaki disease before, but really knew nothing about it. As I was reading the symptoms listed, the little girl from earlier in the day immediately popped into my mind, and I thought, oh, that sounds exactly like her, but then dismissed it. This is such a rare disease, she just has an infection. The following day at work, the parents of the little girl called, needing to see the doctor right away as the antibiotics were not working. When I saw her name on the schedule, the article came back to me, and I told the doctor about it. All of her symptoms fit exactly, and he immediately looked up the disease to refresh his memory on the proper treatment plan and protocols. Sure enough, when the little girl came in, she was still just as sick, if not more so. And the doctor referred the family to the ER, the emergency room, with a note for the doctor to rule out Kawasaki disease. Today, we got a report back that she has admitted with Kawasaki disease and is undergoing treatment as I write this. I wanted to let you know how important what you are doing is and that you've already potentially saved this little girl's life. If not for your article, she most likely would not have been diagnosed. This is a disease that is touched upon briefly in medical school, along with thousands of other rare diseases. It is not incompetence on the doctor's part when they misdiagnose this disease. It is just lack of awareness or the need for a reminder to consider it, as it presents so much like other common illnesses. Thank you and keep up the amazing work. So thank you for allowing me to share this story. All of that I got to them.
Those were very poignant remarks. Reporting from Australia, I'd like to welcome up Shirley Mates. Got to know Shirley back in 2005 when she came to the symposium in San Diego. So welcome, Shirley.
You're welcome. I'm Shirley Mates. I'm here with my husband, Brian. Our son, Cameron, who had KD 20 years ago, unfortunately is working, so he couldn't attend. The KD Foundation Australia is a national voluntary parent-led charity. We are registered to fundraise in almost every state. We have two national coordinators, myself and Ailey Sundstrom. Would you like to stand up for a moment, Ailey? And we also have state coordinators. As a South Australian coordinator, Adele Raslin, stand up, Adele, sorry, is also present here today, and as well as one of our state support volunteers, Peter Lindsay. Stand up, Peter. Like every parent in this room, our lives changed direction when our boys contracted KD. For Ailey and myself, that was about 18 to 20 years ago. It was because of our experiences and lack of knowledge that we set up the foundation to assist others. We have a website and a Facebook page which are regularly updated, and from these a lot of email support is generated. We work closely with the US Foundation and we really appreciate all their assistance. As well as supporting families in Australia, we've had contact with families in New Zealand and the Philippines. This support has been extended by organising family picnics and coffee lunch get-togethers. We also assist Professor Bergner, who is also present at this symposium, with his research. We assist with recruiting parents for research studies, and our long-term goal is to have a national registry. Katie Scord's presentation that we just heard before was very appropriate, and she would endorse this need. The 26th of January is Australia Day, which unfortunately makes it difficult to promote as KD Awareness Day. Australians have other things on their minds, such as barbecues and fireworks. However, this year, Nadal seized the opportunity to fundraise and spread awareness at an Australia Day Fun Day. We have also run parent information sessions and presentations for maternal health nurses, Rotary clubs, etc., and have assisted with medical articles. We are always looking for opportunities to increase awareness. For example, a TV show that presented a story on KD where Dr. Burns' wind study was featured. We've also done newspaper articles. These are often parents' stories about their KD experience. Fundraising awareness events. These are often including schools, which is usually where a KD child attends. And we often also have community events where KD parents might have a contact. We also have in the future we have an upcoming events like this car show. That's the one. In closing, our main challenge for the future is how to keep parents involved once their children are recovered. Even a lot of doctors tell parents to forget that their child has even had KD. As well as this hurdle, we are competing against a lot of well-known charities who are highly publicised, and as a result, they receive a lot of community support and funding. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to share our experience and ideas.